Of the multitude of species that inhabit the James River, none so richly link us to our past as Virginians as the Atlantic Sturgeon.
I grew up right around the corner, and this wasn't going on when I grew up. There he is.
This prehistoric giant has barely changed its appearance since the Triassic period.
Oh, one just jumped right there.
Sometimes growing up to 14 feet in length, weighing up to 800 pounds, and living well into their 60s.
Pulling it in. We'll go to the other side, we'll pull with the tide.
Despite their rugged exterior, which is made up of rows of armored plates called scutes, they are gentle bottom feeders, surviving off worms, shellfish, and crustaceans. While they spend their adult life swimming and living in the Atlantic Ocean, every spring and fall, sturgeon return to spawn in the waters where they were born. They return home to the mighty James River.
I did get a question about where these sturgeon live and if they live in the James River their whole lives. No, they do not. It's very rare to see them in the James, not only because they're endangered, but because these fish are anadromous. Everyone say anadromous.
Anadromous!
What does that mean?
Great question, Brandon. An anadromous fish is a fish that is born in fresh water. So it's born right here in the James River. And then when it gets a certain age, it makes its way to the ocean and lives its life in the ocean. Until it's ready to have kids, it comes back into fresh water. So these fish aren't always in the James River.
There it is!
Arriving in the New World proved challenging, threatening, and different for early settlers. But the Atlantic sturgeon was a welcome sight for colonists who were familiar with the similar sturgeon plentiful at that time in the River Thames back home in England. In the early 1600s, the Jamestown colonists described a rite of passage in which young Powhatan Indian men would ride on the backs of the massive sturgeon in the James River. Regardless of its truthfulness, what remains is a significant respect for this amazing fish, for much more than just the protein it provided.
I feel, Jack, if we ever had a national fish, it should be Atlantic sturgeon.
Yes, certainly. Yeah.
If it were not for Atlantic sturgeon, we probably would not be having this conversation in English. We'd be having it in French or Spanish, because all those original colonists at Jamestown, it's a good chance they would have all died of starvation. The sturgeon sustained them through at least a portion of that period down there.
Through the starving days in that winter.
Ready?
Atlantic sturgeon was so popular as a source of meat and caviar that by 1890, the population was nearly destroyed by commercial fishermen who caught up to 800,000 pounds of sturgeon a year in Virginia. Overfishing soon took its toll. Coupled with erosion from agriculture and runoff from new land development, the sturgeon found its once clean and healthy home now filled with sediment, making it no longer a safe place to swim and multiply.
They're very, very important fish, not because they're cool, but because they are that canary in the coal mine. We see sturgeon starting to die from the dissolved oxygen, we got a real problem.
In 1972, Congress passed the Clean Water Act, the principal law regulating water pollution and setting goals for all U.S. waters to be swimmable and fishable. 2 years later, the Virginia Marine Resources Commission banned sturgeon fishing in Virginia waters in the hopes that the once plentiful fish would repopulate after years of damage.
Yeah, I was standing right up there on that bridge, right there in the middle, looking down, and they were right below me, and I saw three of them coming up this way. And they were breaching about every minute or so.
How big were they?
Oh, the one I saw had to be at least 8 foot long.
Really?
Seemed like at least 7 or 8 foot long.
In 1997, a reward program established by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, Virginia Marine Resources Commission, and the Chesapeake Bay Foundation asked commercial watermen to aid in the catch, tag, and release of Atlantic sturgeon. Fear that the sturgeon had all but vanished was happily discredited when more than 300 of the fish are caught as a result of the program. And then, in 2004, a yearling was captured in the James, offering definitive proof that sturgeon were spawning in the river.
Small guy. This is one of the smallest ones we've ever caught.
The U.S. Geological Survey concluded that there is a sturgeon population distinct only to the James River.
Okay, so fork, 134, tote, 155,
kick,
57.
You know, you chip your dog, we do the same thing with sturgeon. 202. 203.
To give this amazing fish a fighting chance, and in an effort to restore the sturgeon to its once impressive range and historic stature, a team of organizations and agencies banded together in 2006. The U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, the Virginia Institute of Marine Science, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, VCU Rice River Center, and the James River Association began working together toward innovative solutions to revive the species.
The fact that they're survivors. Think about the animals they used to have to avoid, the mass extinctions they lived through. A lot worse than great whites nowadays. Stuff that would probably eat great whites.
Probably last year, it's still soft.
They're tough guys. They're tough fish. So if you just give them the opportunity, if you stop killing them before they spawn, they'll come back. And we're seeing that.
In 2010, 2,500 tons of boulders were carefully placed on the James River bottom near Hopewell to form the nooks and crannies conducive to sturgeon spawning conditions.
I believe that spawning habitat is limited. It doesn't take much. It doesn't take a foot of sediment on top of hard bottom to kill eggs. It only takes a very, very small amount.
Over the next 3 years, two more experimental spawning reefs were designed and built in the lower James below the fall line.
This is an egg mat, so it's something we're putting on the bottom of the reef. It's a section of the reef covered so that if a fish were to be down there laying eggs, hopefully a sturgeon, we'd be able to pull it up and see that there were actually eggs down there.
There's no parental care. All they do is just give them their best chance by finding the right habitat. So they just release hundreds of thousands to millions at a time and hope for the best.
In 2013, coinciding with the building of the third sturgeon reef, JRA released its biennial report, The State of the James, which gave the overall health of the river a grade of C, up 2% from 2 years prior. The report's findings concluded that the score was hampered by several factors where the health of the James continues to struggle, most notably sediment pollution, one of the largest impediments to the sturgeon's comeback.
Sedimentation is not one of those warm and fuzzy issues that people want to wrap their arms around. But the James River Association has taken that on. It's going to take that kind of effort for us to ensure that the habitat's here for those fish to continue to spawn in the river.
The Environmental Protection Agency lists sediment from contaminated runoff as the most common pollutant in rivers, streams, lakes, and reservoirs. However, it is also the pollutant that we can all help to prevent and reduce in our own communities across the watershed. Some things you can do in your own homes, neighborhoods, and schools to prevent and reduce polluted runoff from entering the river are: install a rain barrel. You can pick up after your pets. You can scoop the poop. You can plant native plants and trees to help retain sediment. You can reduce the use of pesticides and limit the use of fertilizers, especially making sure to check the weather before you put fertilizers on your lawn. You can help by keeping storm drains clear in your neighborhood of oil, litter, and leaves, making sure that none of these things rush down to our James River.
There we go. What I learned is we saw a couple of animals, how beautiful it was, and if we keep the environment safe and clean, I think we could have a beautiful place to live in.
But it is only by innovatively addressing sediment pollution and advocating for stronger measures to protect water quality in the James River that we can ensure that this historic fish has a great return.